Hi everyone, this is Kalyan Kumar and welcome to Chemistry Universe. In the last lecture, we talked about the deuterium exchange. We talked about structural isomers before that. We talked about chain isomers, positional isomers, functional isomers. We talked about ring chain isomers. We talked about tautomers. And they were all under the structural isomers. So the basic structure of the molecule had changed. But now we're going to look into a very special category of isomers, which is probably not that intuitive as the structural isomers are. And these are the stereoisomers. And as I had begun this lesson with the classification of isomers, you saw there were three types of stereoisomers. And these were the geometrical isomers, the optical isomers, and the conformational isomers. So we'll begin this lesson by starting with geometrical isomers. So this particular video is dedicated to geometrical isomers. Of course, there will be a follow-up video of this. This is part 3, and we will have a part 3b, which talks about certain unique kind of geometrical isomers besides the one that we are going to talk about. But this is the primary video, and that is a secondary video which is useful for certain higher level exams like the Olympiads. So let's get on with the basic video on stereoisomers, starting with geometrical isomers. In geometrical isomers, the first thing that we're going to learn is, what are stereoisomers? Stereoisomerism arises when two or more molecules have the same structure, that is connectivity, but different arrangements of atoms in space. Now, I've already given you a basic idea about what geometrical isomers are or what stereoisomers are in general. It's like saying that there are two molecules, their connection is the same. A is connected to B, B is connected to C, C is connected to D, and the number of bonds they are connected with is also the same. But somehow, there is some difference between these two. And that is because of the orientation of groups in space. Sometimes the groups are oriented in such a way that the distances between two particular groups is close. And the other, the distances in space are different. They are higher or they are lower. And therefore, this gives rise to some energy difference between these two isomers. And if you remember, any property that is different for two molecules makes the two molecules isomers of each other. So, geometrical isomerism arises when there is a restricted rotation about a certain bond. But having a restricted rotation about a bond does not necessarily cause geometrical isomerism. The basic criteria that enables geometrical isomerism to exist is the fact that there is restricted rotation about a certain bond. And when I say restricted rotation, that means the rotation barrier, the barrier to rotate is so high that it cannot be achieved at normal temperature. The two can be interconverted through chemical reactions, which enable you to break the bond. Without breaking the bond, they cannot be interconverted. But again, just because of this condition existing does not necessarily imply that geometrical isomerism will exist, because for that to exist, there are certain other conditions also required. Restricted rotation is generally observed in C double bond C or C double bond N or N double bond N or even in rings. The atoms around whom the rotation is restricted must also have different groups in them, which causes different aerial distances. Say for example, I have a C double bond C. C double bond C, and remember carbon has a valence of 4. So these two C's must also be connected to two more groups if they are attached by single bonds. So let's say I've got a C double bond C, and one group on this C is A, another group is B. On this carbon, let's say I have A, I have another B. It's not necessary that both of them should be only A and B, they can be C and D also. But for the time being, let's assume C double bond C, this C is connected to A, this C is connected to B, another C connected to A, connected to B. If the two A's are close, there will be some energy of the molecule. If this A were here and the B was here, the A's will be opposite, the B's will be opposite. The moment the distances, the aerial distance between A and A or A and B changes, this gives rise to difference in energy. It is also manifested itself, it will also manifest itself in terms of different properties. But the basic thing is the energies will be different. And therefore, they are geometrical isomers. So the compounds like ABC double bond CAB or ABC double bond CAD or ABC double bond CCD will show geometrical isomerism, unlike AAC double bond CCD. So obviously, if this C holds both A's and this may have different groups, doesn't matter. This is A, this is A. The A is closer to B and this A is closer to C. So if I flip them across, if the C comes here and the B comes here, doesn't change anything. There is still A, C distance, there is still A, B distance having same. And therefore, this would not constitute geometrical isomers. So the second condition required is that the bonds around which the rotation is restricted, those two atoms around which the bond is restricted must also contain different groups. This C should have two different groups. This C should have two different groups. The groups in turn may have some commonality, may not have any. That doesn't matter. Alright, let's see the various types of geometrical isomerism. The first and the simplest is the cis-trans isomerism. Now, if one group on one of the carbons is identical with that of the other carbon and if these groups lie on the same side of the compound, the molecule is called cis or else trans. Now, we need to distinguish these two molecules in their name also. Because after all, remember, we have to write an IUPAC name. And the IUPAC name should contain all information regarding not only the connectivity, should also contain information about aerial distance. Only then you'll be able to draw the right molecule here. So suppose I have this compound. Now if you notice, this HCH3, these two are different. HCH3, these two are different. So this will have a geometrical isomer. Now the two H's are close, the two CH3's are close. And look at this compound. CH3s are away. The two hydrogens are away. Energies will differ for these two. And this says that if these groups lie, if one group on one of the carbon atoms, let's say H, is identical with that of the other carbon, H, and if these two lie on the same side, it is cis. If they lie in the opposite side, it is trans. So this is how you distinguish cis and trans. It is not necessary that if the two H are common, these two should also be common. This could be CH3, this could be CH5. Doesn't matter. The two H are together, cis. If they are opposite, trans. Obviously, if all the four are different, you cannot use cis and trans. And we'll see how to distinguish them. So remember, as I said, H and CH3, H and CH5. This is still cis because the two H are together. And this is trans because the two hydrogens are apart. Now let's see the same thing in rings. Remember, in rings also rotation is restricted. Because if you try to take the bond of the ring and try to twist it, free rotation means you can easily twist it. But restricted means you cannot twist it. So in a ring, if you try to twist these two groups, it is not possible to twist only two groups. The entire ring will flip. The entire ring will have to get twisted. So either you can turn the inside ring upside down, which doesn't change any orientation. Or you'll have to twist this separate from this, but they are all connected in a ring. It's not possible. So there is a restricted rotation in ring also. So these two, this particular molecule is called 1-2 cis, because the positions are 1 and 2. If I label this as 1, this will automatically become 2. And this is called 1-2 trans. But remember, in the case of a ring, it is not necessary the two groups should be attached to the carbons that are attached to themselves. This carbon is not attached to this carbon. Yet, there is no rotation possible in this molecule. And therefore, this is still a cis, but it will be called 1-3 cis. 1-2-3. 1-3 trans. Now, you might wonder, why am I saying 1-3? Because this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, or this could be 1, this could be 2, this could be 3. You might ask, okay, why don't I go this way? In that case, it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, because remember, in IUPAC name, the substituents must get the lowest possible number. So if this is 1, number it like this. If this is 1, number it like this. Alright, you can even have a 1-4 cis. This is a 1-4 cis example. And then you can have a 1-4 trans. Alright, the next one is called the syn-anti-isomerism. Here, we generally use oxymes as example. Oxymes are basically C double bond N, and the N contains an OH. That is called an oxime. Now remember, this carbon should have two different groups for any geometrical isomerism. This anyway has two groups. One is lone pair, one is OH. If the H is with the OH, we call it syn. But if the H were opposite to OH, we call it anti. But what if this was not an H? What if this was another type of R? Of course, the two R's have to be different enough to have geometrical isomerism. So here we say this R is closer to OH, we say syn R. Or we can say this R prime is away from OH, we call it anti R prime. So this is syn R or anti R prime. Whereas this one is syn R prime and anti R. Another example for syn-anti is azobenzene. Azobenzenes are N double bond N and both N's attached to benzene rings. And the two N will automatically have a lone pair. Now this is syn. PH and PH are together. You can also call them as cis here. This is anti. You can also call them as trans here. But what if one pH was R? Doesn't matter, the lone pairs are together, syn. The lone pairs are away, anti. You can also call them as cis and trans. We also use syn anti in hydrozones. Hydrozones are C double bond N, N having NH2. Now here what do? Well, we again use the H just like we did in the case of OH. H closer to NH2, syn. H away from NH2, anti. What if this was not an H? It will behave just like an oxime. Syn R, anti R prime. Syn R prime, anti R. Now, this usage of syn, anti, cis, trans are limited in scope. Because there can be cases where there are four groups on the two atoms. All of them are different. And not only are they different, there's no way, there is no NH2, there is no OH for you to say, okay, this is syn or this is anti. And there is no commonality between those four groups to say cis and trans. Then we use the IUPAC system. Remember, even cis-trans can be used in IUPAC system, no problem. But when cis-trans cannot be used, there is only one way of using that. A cis-trans or anti-syn cannot be used, then there is only one way, and that is E and Z or E and Z. So let's say have the E and Z isomerism. If all four groups are different on atoms with hindered rotation, then cis-trans or syn-anti system cannot be used. Obviously, I'm only taking those cases where SYN and NT cannot be used. For such cases, only Z and E system is used. Now, Z is derived from a German word that's called Zeusmen, meaning together, while E stands for Entigen, meaning opposite. The two groups on each atoms are assigned priorities based on a certain set of rules called the Kahn-Ingold prelog or CIP rules. So what we're going to do is, we got a C double bond C, let's say. Two groups attached to this C, two groups attached to this C. And one of the two groups is given priority 1, the other is given priority 2. The same way here. And this 1 and 2 is given based on certain set of rules that we'll discuss now. They are called CIP rules, or the Kahn-Ingold prelog rule. Once you determine 1 and 2, 1 having higher priority, 2 considered to be lower priority. If the 1s are together, we call it Z. If the 1s are opposite, we call it E. Let's check. One group gets higher priority 1 and the other groups gets the lower priority 2. If the same priority groups are on the same side, the molecule is designated Z or else E. Now remember, Z and E can also be used wherever cis-trans or syn-anti is used. So if you want, you can use Z and E everywhere and it'll perfectly be fine. But then the questions that you'll get, you would not probably have this asking you every time that whether it is Z or E. Sometimes they'll ask you whether it is cis or trans, whether it is syn or anti. So it is important to know what is cis and trans, important to understand when you use syn and anti, and also important to know what E and Z are and how are they predicted, and how can a cis trans be converted to EZ and syn anti be called into E and Z. So let's look at the CIP rules. Now, these rules are very simple, but sometimes people make a mess of it. So we'll be listing each rule carefully. The first connected atom with the highest atomic number is given the highest priority. Highest priority means priority 1. So what you do, you have a C double bond C, 4 groups attached. We are comparing these two. Then we'll compare these two. These two among themselves, these two among themselves. Look for the immediate atom, the first atom attached to this C double bond carbon. Look at the first atom of the other group attached to this C double bond carbon. Compare these two in terms of their atomic number. The one with a higher atomic number will get priority 1, the other one will get 2. Let's check. So, I got this. Now, tell me whether it is E or Z. Look at the priority first. I compared with Cl. Which do you think has higher priority in terms of atomic number? Obviously, iodine. So, this gets 1, this gets 2. Out of F and Br, which has a higher atomic number? Obviously, Br. This gets 1, this gets 2. Are the ones opposite? Yes, it's E. So it's that simple. Now the question will be, what if the two groups are different, but the first connected atom is the same? Carbon here and carbon here. Well, then the rule is, look at the atoms connected to this carbon in this group and this carbon in this group. Look at all the groups attached. The atom, the second atom now we'll call it second atom. The second atom of highest priority, that group gets 1. So if this carbon has 2 hydrogens and 1 O, this carbon has 2 hydrogens and 1 N. Now carbon-carbon is same. But the highest atomic number atom in this group is O. The highest atomic number for this atom is N. O has higher atomic number than N. 1, 2. So, if the first connected atom has the same atomic number but different atomic mass isotopes, then the one with the greater atomic mass is given higher priority. Yeah, this is something which I missed. This basically means that if you have 1H and 1D, then obviously you will be able to figure out based on atomic mass. Now, if the first connected atom is same, then check the second connected atom, as I said, of both groups. The one which has the second connected atom of highest atomic number is given higher priority. So let's look at this example first, the atomic mass one. Obviously, this is 1, this is 2 because of atomic mass. Now look at this one. Now if you notice here the carbon is attached to 3 hydrogens, right? Whereas here, the carbon is attached to 2 hydrogens and it attached to 1 carbon. So out of H, C and H, which has the highest atomic number? C, second atom. Whereas here, all the second atoms are hydrogen. So two hydrogens, they match. So now you compare this hydrogen with this carbon, which is a higher atomic number, carbon. This should get 2 and this should get 1 and this should get 2. So you should get 1 and 2. So what do you think this is? E. Now, if the second highest atomic number atom is same, then look for the number of such atoms. More the number, higher is the priority. Say for example, I got a C here. This C is connected to 2 C's. This C is connected to 1 C and 2 hydrogen. Now, the second highest atomic number atom here is C. There also the second highest atomic number atom is C. But there are 2 of them. This has only 1 of them. 1, 2. So look at this example. This guy is always 1 and 2. Okay, I'm keeping this D and H constant everywhere. Out of these 2 groups, which one do you think gets higher priority? C2H5. What is C2H5? C2H5 is CH2CH. What is this guy? It is CH connected to 2CH3. Now, first atom is same. The second highest atomic number atom is CC, but how many C's does this have? It has 1 and this has 2. So we can call it the valency shell. I'm not going to call it valence shell. Don't confuse it with an atom. An atom has a valence shell. Here I'm going to call it valency shell. So look at all the valencies and then decide. So if you want to look at all the valencies and decide, this is how you would do it. You would say this C has, now already it is attached to 1 C, right, with a double bond. So one valency is anyway satisfied here. 3 more valencies to be satisfied. So valency, 2 of them satisfied by H, 1 by C. Whereas in the other case, 2 of them are satisfied by C and 1 is H. Now C and C is common. H and H is common. But this C and H, the C wins. So automatically, this group gets a higher priority. So it is 1 and 2, and this is Z. Now, if the second highest atomic number connected atom and its number is also same, then look for the third one. And if that is also same, look for the fourth one, and so on. Let me say H and let me say D. Now, highest atomic number atom C. Highest atomic number atom C. So look at all the valencies. C matches with C. C matches with C. Now you're left with H and D. D takes higher priority. So this group gets a higher priority than this fellow. Now comes the question of multiple bonds, and this is something which is really tricky and you need to pay a lot of close attention to this. So at this moment of time, be very, very focused on what you are going to see. For multiple bonds, the phantom or ghost atom concept is used. Now, what does that mean? Suppose I have this and I want to check its priority. Now, if you are going to check this priority, the way you need to check this is, this carbon is attached to one real carbon. but attached to this carbon by a double bond. So we will say this carbon is attached to one carbon, one real carbon, and this pi bond carbon, we call it a ghost carbon. So this carbon CH can be assumed to be attached to one carbon, which is CH2 of course, and one ghost carbon, and ghost carbon is written as a carbon inside a square bracket, and the valency of this carbon is never written, it is only shown with a single valency. Now this carbon in turn is attached to this carbon with a pi bond. So this carbon is attached to this carbon by a real bond, and this carbon is attached to a ghost carbon. Because remember, the carbon's valencies have to be satisfied. So this carbon now has valency for one is this bond, this C, this H, and this C. This carbon's valency is satisfied, 2H, one bond with C, one bond with the ghost C. So we are trying to convert a multiple bond, we are going to convert rings like this, by like all straight chain single bond. So this is written as this. Now try and get this. If you don't get this, don't go forward. Keep looking at this. Let me explain this once again. This is this carbon, right? And this valency is the valency attached here. Now it has got one H. I've written that one H. That it needs two more valencies. In reality, it's a double bond. For our priority sequence, we say single bond real C, single bond ghost C. The pi bond is a ghost. This C, on the other hand, has two hydrogen. It is attached to this carbon, real carbon, by one bond. And the pi bond is replaced as a ghost C. So this is how you're going to use this priority rule. You'll say, okay, C, this C is attached to two C's and one H. This C is attached to two C's and one H, and so on. So that is how you're going to look at the priority rule. All right. Let's try one more. Let's try this. Now I want you to pause the video now, and I want you to write what it is equivalent to. So play it back once you're done. All right. So this C, it is attached to a real N. It has got no other valency. It's got attached to a real N. Once sigma bond is real, pi bonds are ghost. So pi bond n. What about this n? Sigma bond real C, ghost C, ghost C, all valencies are satisfied. So in fact, this molecule should be written like this. Let's try a couple of more examples. Okay, so let's look at this one. Can you write this on your own? Pause, write it on your own. So this C attached to a real CH3, no issues there. Attached to a real O, sigma is real, pi is ghost. This O, on the other hand, ghost C. I hope you're getting the hang of it. So hence, double bonds are duplicated and triple bonds are triplicated. Sigma bonds are real and pi bonds are ghost. So based on that, remember the bracket ones are the phantom atoms or the ghost atoms. Based on that, tell me the isomer. Which isomer is this? Obviously, D gets 1, H gets 2, not an issue. What about CHO and CH2OH? Well, this is how you're going to use. You're going to say CH2OH has got two hydrogens and one OH. There is no issue here. All are single bonds anyway. CHO, on the other hand, this is CHO, remember. On the other hand, this guy is C, single bond H, real oxygen. Sorry, it's a real oxygen, no square bracket here. It's real oxygen and a ghost oxygen, and this oxygen has a ghost C. compare these two. CC, H, H common. Oreal, Oreal common. But look at this H, and you gotta see here. The valency shell shows you that this fellow is having higher priority. So CHO is 1, this is 1, this is 2. Here, this is 1 and this is 2. This is definitely Z isomer. So let's take one more example. So now, tell me, what would you say in this one? Okay, D and H, not an issue. What about CHO and CHOH twice? This is how you check this out. C, H. I'm looking at CHO. Double bond O. One real O, one ghost O. This O has the real C and one ghost C. If you look at here, you have a CH and you have OH and you have a O. You have a OH. Now, what will you see? This is the way you want to see. C common, H common, O common. But remember, this is two O's, even this is two O's. Out of the two O's, this has a C attached. This doesn't have anything attached. This at least have an H attached, but this O has an H attached. So, out of H and C, the highest atomic number is C. Now, you may say, okay, this got an H and this doesn't have anything. Obviously, having something is better than not having something. But this O has only an H attached, whereas this O had a C attached. Though it may be ghost, but that is the way you got to look at it. So the CHO, remember, once you have the same number of atoms, look at what those atoms are attached to and look for the highest one. H, H, 0, C. This O is attached to H, this O is attached to H. This O is attached to nothing, this O is attached to C. Out of C, nothing, H and H, which is the highest, C. So, CHO gets 1, this gets 2, it is Z. Now, here you may get a little bit confused, so let me state this again. First atom, same. It is attached to H, that is attached to H. That is attached to a ghost O, and that O will not have its valency satisfied because it's a ghost O. This O has an H. This C has another OH. That C has a OC. So if the second atom is the same, that is O, and the number of second atoms are also same, and if the third atoms are also same, then look at what are the nature of the third atoms. The third atoms in this case are 0 in the case of the ghost O, C in the case of the second O, whereas here both O's are attached to H. So you got H, H, you got 0, C, highest. C, 0, H, H. C is highest. Go with that. Now here there is a very tricky point, and that is that if there is a conflict between real atoms and phantom atoms, then the real atoms get higher priority. Now this is something which is misunderstood by most people. And some people are not even able to figure out where this will be applied. And I'll tell you the mistake that people make. This is the mistake that people make. Suppose, in this, some people make this mistake. They say, okay, C double bond OH is equivalent to C O phantom, O real, and this O, this C phantom. Remember, this is this. Whereas in this case, you have a CH,
second case, and you got a OH, you got a OH, and they say, oh look, here there is one real O and one fake O. Here there are two real O's, and if there is a conflict between real and phantom, then the real gets high priority. No. This should be only used when the valency shell is exactly the same in both. What does it mean? Here, the O may not be attached to anything, but this O is attached to C. This O is attached to H, which I've already mentioned before. And therefore, this C wins. Till all the valencies everywhere is same, you cannot use this. You have to use valency shell first. Second mistake. Some people compare this and they say, okay, I got a OH here and a OCH3 here and L. And they say, now tell me, what is this equivalent to? C, ghost O, real O, ghost C. What about this guy? C, real H, real O, H, real C. No, don't look at real anything. Just look at the fact C is attached to H. This C is attached to H, same. Okay? Attached to two O's. Doesn't matter ghost or real, treat them same. Two O's. This is attached to C, this is attached to C. But can you see that this C is attached to three hydrogens? This C is not. Can you see this O is attached to one H? This O is not. So the valency here is zero, whereas the valency here is H. So the valency shell itself tells you this should get a higher priority. So this is not between fake and real. Fake and real need to be compared as fake and real only when all the valency shells are same. So let me give you an example when that happens. Most people don't understand this example or don't know such an example can exist. Look at this one. Think about it. 1, 2, easy. Now what is CHO? CHO is H, ghost O, no valency, real O, ghost C, no valence. Now look at this one, CH, one O, no valency, one O, C, no valency. Now can you see the valency cannot tell you the difference between this group and this group? Obviously the two groups are different. Now you will say, what the hell does single O means? It's got one unpaired electron. You may ask, what the hell does one C mean? Well, maybe it's got three unpaired electrons. So if you were to compare this with CHO, where CHO is written like this, the valency can never tell you what is the difference between the two. CH, CH, O without any bond, O without any bond, O, O, bond C, and the C is not bonded to anything. Bond C, C is not bonded anything. But the difference is, this O is real. This C is real. And the real wins over the fake one. So here, you use this generalization 1 and 2, and this becomes E. Now, you can treat rings in the same way. Rings are treated as branched chain. How do we do that? Now this is going to get pretty complicated, so be very, very careful. I'm only going to look at this and this. Multiple bonds we've already done. So if you look at the first one, you treat it like this. Real C, real O, real O. But this O is not vacant. It is attached to a C. But the C is already accounted for. You are starting with this C only. So this C for this O will be depicted as ghost. And it is not only possible that you need to go from here, you need to go from here also. So then you write another C real O, real O, and this real O is connected to the same C, it's a ghost C. Something like this. This becomes this. Try and understand this. Very, very essential for you to understand. CH. Okay? Because this, remember, this carbon has an H. Now, first you go this way. O, real O. Real O. And since we are going back to this carbon, which is already written here, we write ghost. Now go this way. Real O. Real O. Now this O is attached to the same C which is already written here. So ghost. Try writing this on your own. Pause the video now. Try writing this on your own. Now remember, these concepts are not that easy. But you got to master them. So start with this C. What does this C contain? This C contains an H. Okay? Now let's go from here first. O. Real O. C. Real C. And of course, I'm not writing the two H, but they have to be written. C. Real C. C is attached to real O. But this O goes back to the same C, ghost. And then, go from this side, real O. You just have to repeat it because it's symmetrical. This is what is this one. And this is how you compare. So if you were to compare this, now compare these two, which is one, which is two. O, O. Can you see the next one is O, the next one is C? Pretty simple, this is one. So, this is one, this is two in this case, and that you can check yourself. This is one and this is two and this is Z. So just imagine if you had benzene, what would you have done? If you had benzene, oh my God, you'll be in real trouble, man. Now, just look at this. This is a carbon. Real carbon, ghost carbon. This carbon is also attached to this carbon by a pi bond, ghost carbon. Then real carbon. This carbon is attached to another real carbon. Then a ghost carbon. Then a ghost carbon. So we reach still here. Then this carbon. Real. This carbon is attached to another real carbon. This one. Both are attached to ghost. And then this carbon is attached to this carbon again, which will be treated like a ghost. Now you got to go this way, the anti-clockwise. So the same thing repeats itself. So if I were to draw clearly, it should be like this. Wow. See? It is this C, okay? Then this is this C. Attached to a ghost. This also is attached to a ghost because there's a pi bond. Real carbon, this one. Ghost carbon because of this pi bond. Single carbon, this carbon. Ghost carbon because of this pi bond. Real carbon, this one. This carbon is attached to this carbon by real and ghost. This carbon is attached to this carbon by real and ghost. But this carbon gets back to the original carbon which you've already written, another ghost. And the same repeat from the other side. So this is how you are going to write it. Now suppose if beyone this you have lone pairs. Remember oxymes we talked about? Remember the priority of a lone pair is less than that of an atom. A bond pair is more having a higher priority than a lone pair. So what do you think this is? Cl obviously is better than CH3 in terms of priority, 1, 2. And here the bond gets priority, lone pair gets less priority. This is E. Now suppose I have a carbon in which there are two alkenes sitting, but one alkene is a Z isomer, the other alkene is a E isomer, then the Z gets priority over E. And if you will study optical isomers, there you will find R and S. R gets priority over S. So for stereoisomeric forms, Z takes priority over E and R takes priority over S. For example, let me show you Z and E here. Obviously, ethyl group is higher priority than methyl, so we settle this 1 and 2. But here, if you notice, all the connections are same. CH, double bond, CH, CH3. CH, double bond, CH, single bond, CH3. So you write all of them with all the GOs and everything, they'll be the same. But can you see this is a cis, this is a Z1. The two hydrogens are here. And the two hydrogens are here. This is the E1. The Z gets higher priority. So this is 1, this is 2, this is Z. So now let's look at the geometrical isomerism in cycloalkenes. Now cycloalkenes with less than 8 carbons cannot show geometrical isomerism due to double bond at least. Remember, a ring can show geometrical isomerism due to two groups being up and one being up and one being down. But if you want to have a double bond, less than 8 carbons, you will never find a ring existing in the trans form or the anti form. It will always be cis if there is a double bond. So if somebody were to ask you, what do you think about this one? Well, this one only exists in this form. What do you think about this one? There is no trans form here. But what about this one? It's an 8-membered ring. This can have cis and trans. This is the cis and this is the trans, and the trans will be a little difficult to understand. But trans you can understand by the fact that the two hydrogens are at a distance from each other rather than these two, they are close. And why does it happen like that? Well, greater the ring size, more flexible the rings are. So in 8, anything more than 8 will have both cis and trans, but specifically for 8, 9, 10 membered rings, the cis form is more stable than the trans form. And that we don't have to understand right now, that we'll do in conformations. So now let's calculate some geometrical isomers. So first case, if a molecule capable of showing geometrical isomerism, that could be due to a double bond or due to a ring, and it cannot be divided into two equal halves, that means it is non-symmetrical, then the total number of geometrical isomers are 2 to the power n. Of course, you can use logic. You can just try and draw them and stuff. But this is an easier way to remember this. And what is n? N is the number of geometrical isomer contributing centers. That is number of double bonds and rings wherever geometrical isomerism can exist. Say for example this one. Now there is a mistake here. This is not H2. It is only H. Okay. Can you see geometrical isomerism is possible here? Yes. Geometrical isomerism possible here? Yes. Why? This is attached to two different groups, H and AT. They are attached to two different groups, H and all this. This is attached to H and all of this. This is attached to H and ME. And can you see, I cannot break them into identical halves. I cannot say, okay, it's identical here because this is ET and this is ME. So in such a scenario, it is simply 2 to the power n. So number of geometrical contributing centers are 2 here, 1 here and 1 here. 2 to the power 2, that is 4. You will totally get 4 isomers. The second case, if a molecule capable of showing geometrical isomerism can be divided into two identical halves, it's a symmetrical one, then the total number of geometrical isomers is given as 2 to the power n minus 1 plus 2 to the power p minus 1, where p would be n by 2 when n is even and p would be n plus 1 by 2 when n is odd. So, look at this one. Geometric, again, there is a mistake here, H2, H. Well, geometrical isomerism is possible here, geometrical is possible here, but can you see they are identical? So here, you have to use the formula, this. And since here the number of geometrical contributing centers, N, is 2, we have to use P is N by 2. So here, since it is 2 and n by 2 will be 1 then. So use this formula, 2 to the power 2 minus 1 plus 2 to the power 1 minus 1, this is 3. Now, why is it 3? Because here you could have a cis trans. This is cis, this is trans. You could have a trans cis, because trans cis would be different. You could have a cis cis, you could have a trans trans. That is what these 4 are about. But here the 3 is, you can have cis trans, but you cannot have trans cis, because this being cis and this being trans, and this being trans and this being cis would give you the same name, because it is identical. Doesn't matter. You'll always have to start numbering it from the place where it is cis. So if the cis was this, you'll number it from here. If the cis was this, you'll number it from here. Doesn't matter. Therefore, cis trans, cis cis, trans trans. There's no trans cis. So only 3. Then you need to have a concept of stereocenter or stereogenic atom. Now, an atom on which interchange of any two group results in a stereoisomer is called a stereocenter or a stereogenic center. So, in a molecule capable of showing geometrical isomers, there are 2 stereocenters for each pair of geometrical isomers. What does it mean? Meaning, if I change these 2 groups on this carbon, I get a new geometrical isomer. Cis becomes trans. But instead of this, if I change the 2 groups here, I'll still get geometrical isomers, cis and trans. Of course, they will be the same cis and the same trans. But the fact of the matter is, I can change it either here or I can change it either here. There are 2 stereocenters or 2 stereogenic atoms. So now let's have a look at the properties of cis and trans. So physical properties of cis-trans isomers. First is the dipole moment. Now, in general, the dipole moment of trans is less than cis. For example, if you look at this one, assuming that the CH does not contribute much to the dipole moment, as their electronegativity differences are not that great, CCl would be like this, CCl would be like this, and this will not have a dipole moment equal to 0, whereas here the dipole moments will get cancelled. Mu not 0, mu 0. Cis is greater than trans. But not all the time, okay? Don't take it as a general thing. Not all the time. Look at this example. C and Me. Me is a plus I group. COH is a withdrawing group. Whereas in the trans version, they will get added at 180 degrees. So this mu trans will be greater than mu cis. If you look at boiling point, then greater the intermolecular forces, greater the boiling point. Greater the intermolecular forces, greater is the boiling point. So, when will be the intermolecular forces great? When the dipole moment is great. Therefore, more polarity implies more boiling point. And since cis generally has more dipole moment than trans, so the isomer with greater dipole moment will have higher boiling point, which is generally cis, but again, not always. Solubility follows the same trend. More the dipole moment, more it will be soluble in polar solvents. And less is the dipole moment, less is the solubility in polar solvents. And perhaps more in non-polar solvents. But melting point is a little different game. The trans can form better in a crystal lattice because of greater symmetry. Remember, the trans also has a center of symmetry besides the plane of symmetry. Therefore, the melting point depends on the ability to pack a molecule in a crystal lattice. Therefore, melting point of trans is greater than melting point of cis. And that can be seen in this example. This is malic acid, the malic with the E. This is fumaric acid. My melting point is 130 here, it is 286 here. So trans has a better packing. When it comes to stability, generally trans form is more stable than the cis form because of steric hindrance. But in some cases, wherever hydrogen bonding is possible, the cis is more stable than trans. See, for example, this one. Even for example, this one. is more stable than the transform. Why? There's no intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Because, remember, Cl has a lone pair. And this Cl has a d orbital, right? So, this will give a plus m. And the Cl will act as minus m. One Cl acts as plus m, the other as minus m, because it has got d orbitals. Because of which, the two Cls will become plus and minus. And if they are closer, the attraction will be greater. And that dipole force would make the cis more stable. But of course, these are not always the case. But remember, if I replace the Cl with a F or a Br or a I, the trans will be more stable. Because remember, F does not have d orbitals. It can never show minus m. And as far as Br and I are concerned, their plus m ability is very low as they are too big compared to carbon atom. So you want to remember this, you want to remember which is more stable in the case of cis and which is more stable in case of trans. Remember this. Just remember CDBSGMB. Cisco's database system is good, Madhavan style is bad. I really don't know anything about Cisco. It's just a mnemonic. So what does this mean? Cis has dipole moment, boiling point and solubility good. Melting point, stability is bad. So cis has dipole moment, and of course these are general cases, okay? Dipole moment, boiling point, solubility in polar solvent, remember, in polar solvent is good. The melting point, stability is bad. So this is how you remember it. So somebody asks you, what is the dipole moment of these two, which is greater? Both are zero. What about this one? Zero. What about this one? Zero. But what about this one? It is non-zero. Why? Because the OH bond is not straight. Sometimes the OH is oriented like this. Sometimes it is oriented like this. If it is oriented like this, the mu is zero. Oriented like this, it is non-zero. And since it will be a mixture of all of them, you will find that this is not going to be zero if you have the two OH at para to each other. So that is the end of this very long video of geometrical isomers. Watch this video as many times as you need to watch to understand this. And I hope this will help you in understanding the intricacies of the geometrical isomers. I will be giving you an add-on of this particular video. I'm going to be putting up a 3B video, which is going to be other types of geometrical isomers, but not to be seen if you are not really preparing for higher level exams like Olympiads. It's only meant for Olympiads as such, Olympiads or KVPY in India, and maybe the advanced tests in SAT or other exams, but not for JEE in particular in India. So with that, this is Kalyan Kumar signing off. Have a great day. Enjoy your day. Study hard and be successful. Thank you.